I'm delighted to welcome Robin McAuley of MSG back to Dawn Osborne in session. Robin, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me. Hello, Dawn.
Have you been keeping your spirits up in the pandemic?
I've been definitely keeping the spirits up. sometimes.
I wondered what you were doing then.
Yes.
No, you've got your new solo album out. So tell us a bit about that.
So I'm going to backtrack a little bit. March of last year, 2020, March 4th, I think it was, I performed my last show in Las Vegas. You know, I do the Raiding the Rock Vault, the classic rock show. And so here I am at home thinking, oh, my God, we should be back very soon. And of course, a year later, yada, yada. And so the record label Frontiers came to me and said, you know, to keep the momentum, why don't you put out a solo record? And I said, I'm really not interested in doing a solo record. And Black Swan had such a great record that I wouldn't want it to distract from that. And they said, no, this would be really good. It'll keep the momentum going, and let's do it. And I said, no, I don't want to. And then there was a break of a couple of months.
Because last time I spoke to you, you told me you might do something along the lines of a Faces record. So clearly thinking has moved on from that.
Well, that's what I wanted to do. And then they came back and they went, people don't know you for doing that. They just need more of what it is that you do. And I went, that's boring. Nobody, it's more of the same. Why bother? So we kind of threw it away. And then a couple of months after that, they went, are you ready now? And I'm going, oh, I really haven't thought any more about it. So I needed to get serious about it. And I thought, what am I going to do then? So I started to reach out to different people, and people had been, you know, asking me the same question for years. Will there be another Grand Prix? And I thought, probably not. And then the last time I saw Phil Lanzon was on a Schenkerfest tour in France. And Phil and I were discussing it, and logistically we thought, you know. So I reached out to Phil and I said, look, next best thing, why don't we write a couple of tunes and see what happens? And then I reached out to Howard Leese, who is the musical director at the Vegas show, also Paul Rogers' company's guitar player. And I said to Howard, give me a Bad Company song, just literally. And so he sent me a really short idea that really was very incomplete. So I worked on it, sent it back to him, and I said, look, this is what I think. And he goes, this is great. And then I submitted everything I had to the label. Then their producer / mixer, Alessandro Del Vecchio, sent me a bucket load of songs. I kind of picked a bunch of ideas that I wanted to work on. And then I rough demoed them, sent them back to him. And he goes, good, we're ready to go. And he's in lockdown. He's in Italy. So his idea was that we could Zoom every time I'd go to record. Of course, I don't have a home studio. I can demo at home, but I needed a studio. So they found me a studio engineer. I really only saw his back for the entire recording because it was just me and him. He wore his mask. And at the very end, when we were done, he took his mask off and we did a selfie. We took a selfie. And he had no idea what I was doing because I wrote all the lyrics and the melodies, sent them to Alessandro. So I came in and he would hit record. I'd start singing for about 2 hours. And we recorded on like a Tuesday and a Thursday, sometimes on a Sunday. And that was the rhythm we got into until it was finished. And so when I'd start singing, he didn't have any idea what the material was like because he was the studio engineer and a really good one, but he was in an awkward spot because it was like I needed somebody to record me. And so we got it done that way, and then we selected the 12 songs, and I was expecting all of these fixes, and Alessandro said, this is great. It's going to start producing.
So there were more songs than 12 then in the beginning.
Alessandro had sent me music to about almost a dozen. Then Phil Lenz and I had written 2 songs with Phil. We picked one of those, Like a Ghost. Howard sent me the one. Then Tony Franklin, the Fretless Monster bass player. Tony sent me a couple. I'd written those. They didn't get picked. And then he sent me to Tommy Denander in Sweden. And Tommy sent me maybe about 4 or 5 songs. 2 of those got picked. So we had plenty of stuff. And I wanted to make it somewhat interesting, you know, not more of all of the same. And so we ended up with what we have. There's actually 11 tracks, and then there's a bonus track for Japan of one of the songs, which is Runaway. Runaway gets the instrumental version. It's very orchestrated, but it's really pretty. It's cool. It's completely different. So there you have it. Your turn.
My reaction, it's classy AOR, really showcases your voice. So it's a great album. There isn't a bad track on the album in my view. So are you happy with it?
I never know. You know, I never know. I get it done. When I'm writing it, I have my own little pet peeves and then my pet favorites. And then I'm thinking, they're never going to pick that track just because I like it. But they went for everything. And now that it's done, I'm really happy. Alessandro picked some really great musicians at his end, especially Andrea Cerveso on guitar. It's just, he's phenomenal.
Yeah, the guitar is mean. I mean, it's really great guitar.
Well, the funny thing is that here in the US, ever since Standing on the Edge came out as a single and then Say Goodbye came out on Friday last, on Good Friday, everybody goes, I just love this Dawkins song. So everybody is now comparing to George Lynch. And in actual fact, a little trivia, the Black Swan album writing is penned in to start today. And Jeff Pilson, when I was talking to him last week, he said, you know, George called me and asked if I had produced the new McAuley record. And I said, no, I haven't. He goes, why? And he said, sounds just like Dawkins. And I swear to God, if it does, it's only because Andrea is a big George Lynch fan. So I guess there is some...
Well, it's a good thing in my view.
So, what if he had sounded like Michael Schenker?
You might have some explaining to do.
Right. So, you know, you take what you get, and he's great. I'm very happy. I'm very happy with him.
And the first single you mentioned, Standing on the Edge. So tell us a little bit about that.
You know, when you're in a lockdown situation, as you were very aware of, and you know, the obvious happened. And I'm thinking, this is shit, you know, we can't go play, we can't go do the stuff that we want to do. And so I started to conjure up all these kind of different lyrics of, okay, what do we have here? What was very apparent to me watching the media and the news was how people were reacting given this atrocious circumstance that we now find ourselves. People were not nice, doing things that you never expected them to do. And all due respect to animals, but the animal in a lot of people started to come out. They're out in the streets and they're destroying things. And there's a behavior going on now that's like, you're going, really, people? You know, we're supposed to pull through this together. We've gotten through worse, you know? And here you are really showing your colors. And I think people who thought their friends might be on the same page as them only to discover they weren't. Everybody is making their political stances and saying all sorts of stuff on social media, and I'm going, nasty little people, you know?
Nasty. I do know what you mean, the toilet roll and, you know, the clearing out the supermarkets and all of that and fighting in the supermarkets over things.
I thought to myself, nasty little hobbitses. So standing on the edge, including the album art cover, really came out of where my thought process was going, and I thought, how would a gargoyle sitting on the top of the building, how would he view this? And so I started thinking of looking down to this mayhem, this horrible nastiness going on. And I sort of wrote the lyrics sort of around that sort of stuff, that we really are on the edge of going forward in the very positive sense, or we just fuck it up, basically, excuse my French, right? And we have an opportunity to change, and we can change for the better, or, you know, and that's really where all of that came. I went, we have a great opportunity here going forward to do something a little bit more than what we're doing right now.
Noble, yeah, a little bit more noble, yeah. And the video, I interviewed Susie Quattro not that long ago, and she filmed a video in her garage, and she said how everybody had to do it on their own, and it looked as though you were on your own in your garage as well. Is that right?
I was definitely in a garage. It wasn't my garage.
But you looked as though you were on your own, apart from maybe the cameraman.
That was the idea. That was the idea of, you know, lonesome me, you know. And we found the director found this great place way out in the desert. I mean, you're going, there was nobody out there except us. And it was full of old cars and bikes, mm-hmm. and old RVs that dated back to the 60s and the 70s. And it was the perfect spot for the idea of the video. And then we used a lot of shots in downtown LA to sort of coincide with the artwork. And, you know, the kid basically works corporate America, and he leaves his happy place in the bank that he works in, and then he walks out into the fresh air and he goes, I'm so done with this. I'm so done with the rat race. I'm so done with having the, you know, the routine of the daily life. And then you see him ending up in the hills out in, he's actually out in Malibu. Nice location. And it's a basically journey. It's him also standing on the edge of a major change in his life. And the whole idea was that we are all in that position. We're here and we need to go through that invisible door into what? Hopefully into something more positive. I don't mean to be all heavy and sort of, man, you know what I'm saying? It's not meant to be like that. But it is a, for myself included, just a an awakening. It's like while we get so complacent, we're so used to what we're used to, you know, yeah. And now we see what's going on around us, and people are just vicious. And I'm going, this has to change.
Time to think. We've all had time to think and prioritize, and also get to know ourselves again, because we've had to spend a lot of time solo, some of us. So
I know. So you know, time. And in a lot of cases, there was just that large glass that was the only thing you could. Oh my God! I think that here in the U.S., at any rate, that the selling rate of alcohol just went through the roof.
And the second single, you mentioned that's out now, Say Goodbye. So yeah. Tell us a little bit about that.
That actually is, and I was laughing to myself when I was writing that, because I went, this virus is a really, really bad relationship. That's what it is. It's an extremely bad relationship, and who would want it? And the entire lyrical content of the song is a bad relationship with the virus, like it is with a one-to-one male-female. And it's like, and I cannot wait to get you out of my life, you know? And it's like, and leave, and make sure that I'm awake when you're leaving, because I want to make sure that you leave that key, because you're never getting back in. And that's really what it was about. And I
really, wow.
And I was laughing to myself, and I'm thinking, oh my God, this is so, it's so, such a bad, because this whole pandemic is a bad movie. And this is a really bad relationship inside the bad movie. And I went, this is what it is. And I just started writing it like it was a relationship. And so it was real easy. And I went, when I get this key back, I will change the locks and you're never getting back in. And that's really it. Very simple.
Okay. Okay. And I've got a few more favorites on the album, actually. Late December, Runaway, which you mentioned there are two versions of. I haven't heard the second, I've only heard the one on the main album. And also my other favorite is Wanna Take a Ride.
Oh,
so those were my three favorites. So so I just wondered, do you want to say anything, are any of those, you know, particular favorites or have interesting stories?
Well, late December is really written about my wife.
Okay.
We'll be married 28 years this year. And when we decided that we were going to be an item, a serious item, it kind of materialized at the end of the year. And she's from Vienna in Austria, short story. And I met her in Germany. And then I met her again in Stockholm, in Sweden. And it was in November. And she came to LA to visit me for Christmas in December, on Christmas Day. And so it was late December.
And okay, so it's a love song, that one.
It's a love song, it's it. And I don't usually do that sort of stuff on a personal level, but this that particular song was written for my wife. Runaway is one of my personal favorites, because it just, when I heard the music, it's so orchestrated and I just fell in love with it. And I went, oh my God, this reminds me of when I grew up in Ireland. Our house used to back out onto like 80 acres of land. And I remember as kids, we'd be way out across the fields. And you know what it's like living in the country, you could see the rain coming. And we used to try and beat the rain home. We never did. We just got our asses soaked.
Okay. Okay.
That's really where that came from. And I went, oh, and that came together really fast, because it was like a boyish childhood thing. And Run, Wanna Take a Ride was very simple, because again, we're in lockdown and I went, I need to go to the beach. I need to go to the beach right now. Beach is about 45 minutes from my front door, not a big stretch. And I went, I have to get out of here, and it's the best place to go. And I want to take a ride, and that's all it was. And it turned out great. I love it. It's very positive message. And I wanted to go that direction in the midst of all of the other stuff. I went, okay, you got to get out of this slump. You got to cheer things up a little bit here. And it's kind of a summer song for me, because I was a big fan of Don Henley's Boys of Summer kind of thing. And I went, I want to do something kind of like that. So that's really it. Yeah. It's okay. A fun song. It's a fun. It's positive. It's up, and it's different than everything else that's on there too. You know.
Mhm. 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 And will you be performing these songs live?
Tomorrow.
when you can.
I have a midnight.
You're in the States, so it's a little bit easier over there.
I have a red eye flight into the UK. I'm actually. Oh my God, not soon enough, Dawn, you know? I think we're all ready. Somebody asked me earlier this morning how I saw the future of the next stage of shows. And I think while everybody is dying to get out there, I think there'll just be a lot of factors in place. Probably the first one will be, if you put a tour together, how's that tour going to shape up? Do you want to go out and play to half an audience in a venue? And can anybody afford to do that? Because if there's, when you put travel together, and when you put all the logistics together, and then you show up at a venue, and obviously you will know ahead of time because the promoters will keep you abreast of all of that, but nobody wants to play to half house. It doesn't make for good business. And then are we going to have a situation where promoters put so many stringent protocols in place that it's impossible to adhere to? Or will the artist put all of those same protocols in place? My artist needs to be taken care of. How can you assure me that blah, blah, blah? And then there's a lawsuit and there's a lawsuit. And it's like, is that what we're going to be confronted with?
Yeah, I hope the vaccination will mean that we'll come out of that.
I agree with that, but I also think that there's a lot of people, even when they have their second shot, I've had my second shots for
a month
or whatever, you know, and I had no side effects, touch wood, bump, you know, I'm one extra pair of wings out of my head, maybe, but I think there's a lot of people, even after they've been fully vaccinated, are not ready to leave their front door. I think they've become totally complacent, and they're going, nope, I'm not going. I don't feel safe. So we have to get over that little hump.
Yeah, there'll be a little hump psychologically at first, but people are dying to go to live gigs here. So, you know, I think they'll have a few beers and then it won't be that difficult. I think they'll find that they're able to do it. Is there anything happening on MSG?
Well, Schenkerfest, of course, at the beginning of the pandemic, we lost sold out tours of Japan and Europe. And then since then, Michael found himself celebrating his 50th anniversary. So he drafted in a whole new lineup of singers to celebrate that. Excuse me. And he, just this morning, I saw advertised that he has 10 or 12 shows lined up for Russia in November. Mm-hmm. But that will be with Ronnie Romero singing. And he did have some like summer festivals in Europe that got canceled again. And then he's supposed to be in the UK in October, also with Ronnie Romero.
Okay. And the reason that you're not doing...
For group. That won't be on the Michael Schenker Fest.
Right. But so because you're in the States, that's, you know, one reason why there aren't so... I mean, I suppose it's more complicated to have four singers at the moment.
He hasn't even discussed that. I think he just wanted to do something different for his 50th anniversary. But it is at this moment in time restricted to Europe only. Now Ronnie is lives in Croatia, if I'm not mistaken. And I don't know how the travel is. I know that I keep reading here that people in the UK can't leave to go international, and then they're not welcoming any US citizens into the UK.
Not at the moment.
And then of course I have to stick this one in, because I also read this morning that this new UK variant is the new culprit that we have to cope with.
Okay. Well, there's more than one, so we're not the only culprits around, I think.
Honestly, I think it's been hit and miss all the way along. Do they really know? Do we really know? Are we being given the full scope of the information? Or is this a play by numbers? Let's see how it goes. You know, it's all I know is that we have to get through this, and we will. You know, we fought two wars already. I was there for both of them. So we will get through this.
Yes. Yeah. Now you mentioned Black Swan. So that's the other thing that you're doing with Reb Beach and Jeff Pilson. And so tell people a little bit more about what's happening on that.
Yes, well, there will be a Black Swan 2. I'm not suggesting that we're going to call it Black Swan 2, but there will be a second album from Black Swan. In actual fact, today, April 8th, Reb lives in Pittsburgh, and Reb is flying in today to get together with Mr. Pilsen, and we're going to start shredding and officially start the Black Swan record today. So,
okay,
you're right. Supposed to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, are there any other projects that you're doing at the moment that you want to tell us about?
That's it for now. I guess everybody's waiting with bated breath to see if we will get back to the Classic Rock Show in Vegas, because I was talking to Doogie White yesterday, and he was saying that it's the first time that he can remember that he hasn't worked for so long. And I said, Doogie, for the last 7 years, I've been singing 5 nights a week, 1,500 shows, and now I'm reduced to like 5 minutes in the shower.
And he wrote, and you look fabulous on it. I mean, you look like you've been coaching really well.
Back to me, he wrote back, he goes, dirty little boy, it's 7 minutes in the shower.
Anyway, it's good to see you in such good spirits, and hopefully we can see light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you very much for making some time to talk to us.
Very welcome. Thank you. Bye.